finished here in just a moment here now. Let's see here. Let's so dreadfully busy here this evening working on this now. Let's see, we've got Jack there, and we've got everything all set up here. My dear, good evening, I'm Zachary here, and I'm busy finishing my opera that I promised that I would write for Gasport. He teased me until, you know. Sorry, Gasport, much too busy to talk tonight. Too busy composing here. So, my dear, I want to borrow the old stake here. There we are, my dear. Now, how's your finger work, eh? Very nice, my dear, very nice. All right, you may whiz into the overture, I think, you know. I've been writing this thing having attended the gala opening in the opera at Vasari last weekend, I decided that I would write my opera and get it over with. You know, I figured that the plot of an opera is not much worse than the plot of a movie, so if you can't lick them, join them, you know. Well, I implemented my decision by writing music and, of course, the libretto to an exciting new work, a masterpiece that probably will never be repeated again after this evening, as a matter of fact. It's entitled Il Draculare. Thank you, my dear. Now, of course, the opera opens with Count Dracula pursuing the beautiful Princess Sananka, you understand? And she's visiting her uncle, Dr. Frankenstein, but Princess Sananka is secretly in love with Larry Talbot, younger brother. He goes under the name of Jack Milton, that's the way I worked it out. And Jack Milton has been unjustly accused, mind you, by the Internal Revenue Department. And he has become a troubadour. He has also just won the head-smashing contest in Vasaria. Princess Sananka, running through the Malaphasia Gardens in a diaphanous dress, off-white tulle, you know. Jack Milton in hot pursuit. So is Count Dracula. Now the two men meet, and they fight, and Dracula has his head smashed, and he sings a dark hymn of revenge, Non voglio giocare in vostra cortile. Tempo, my dear, tempo. I don't want to play in your yard, I don't like you anymore. You'll be sorry when you see me sliding down your cellar door. You can hollow down my rain bar, you can climb my apple tree. I don't want to play in your yard if you won't be good to me.
Much. theory of glandular stimulation through electrical impulses was correct. A few days ago, you were as small as your companion. And now look at you.
This is Dr. Carruthers speaking.
Yeah, this is Heath. Yeah, Henry Maud and I are having a little get-together at my home tonight. We want you to come.
Why, that's nice of you, and I appreciate it. But I'm very busy working on a formula for a new shaving lotion.
Oh, but Doc, this is my daughter's idea. And she's going to be awfully disappointed if you don't show up.
Don't take no for an answer. Make him come.
Yeah, you see, it's a sort of a special occasion.
I bet Mary is going to announce her engagement to that young rascal, Don Morton. Tell her I'll be there. Goodbye.
Well, it's all arranged. He's coming.
He's going to be surprised when he finds the special occasion to present him with this bonus check.
$5,000.
You have not forgotten. You hate this strange oriental fragrance, even while you sleep. Just as you did before I made you big and strong. Now, if you detect the fragrance in the night, and you're fully awake, you will strike. Yes, you will strike. To kill.
Well now, here we go again. Let's get right on to the opera here. Now, you realize Count Dracula was quite annoyed at having his head smashed. So he kidnaps Princess Anka to his castle in the Carpathian Mountains. He discovers there that not only is she not beautiful, but her father, the rich father Amun-Ra, is still alive in Egypt. So the Count, he locks her in his torture chamber, where she sings the haunting lament, Ci sarebbe Iacomo. My father was a lee, as yours you will allow, and you may have a sister who needs protection now. I come to this fair city to find a brother dear, and you wouldn't dare insult me, sir. If Jack were only here on Mickey Mantle, if Jack were only here.
Here's Mickey Mantle.
Well, sir, as Princess Anka was lamenting, Jack Milton set out on his horse, which soon died. And after a brief eulogy, adio, ciao, cavallo vecchio, goodbye, old taint. He leaves his horse and he jumps onto the commuter train. When the train breaks down, he leaps from the coach with a great curse. Non spizzare della carrozza! Della carrozza! Don't spit on the floor. Then he proceeds to the gypsy camp outside the little town of Uspenskaya. Now the gypsies there are singing of the great folk hero McCluskey, who knocked out Attila the Hun in 10 rounds. Throw him down, McCluskey, was to be the battle cry. Throw him down, McCluskey, you can lick him if you try. Future generations with wonder and delight will read on history's pages of the great McCluskey fight. We'll read on history's pages of the great McCluskey fight. We'll read on history's pages of the great McCluskey fight. We'll read on history's pages of the great McCluskey fight.
Hello. Send Johnny Layton in here.
Well, what have I done now? Who wants me fired this time?
Nobody yet, but it's still early. This came in from Heathville. It's a mystery killing. Old Martin Heath's son.
Who's Martin Heath?
Who's Martin Heath? Say, have you ever had a date with a girl?
A girl? Oh, yes, a girl. I believe I did take a girl out once.
Well, did she smell sweet?
Of course she smells sweet. Most girls do.
Well, that's because of Martin Heath Cosmetics Limited. They make all that goo that the women put on their faces so they won't have to wash them with soap and water.
I get it. A big man, huh?
Yes, and a big advertising account. Grab yourself a photographer and get along over there to Heathville. The coroner's holding an inquest. Find out who really killed old man Heath's son.
Okay, McGinney, I'm on my way.
Ah.
let's stop this thing. I can't stand any more of this film. Will you just slow it down here just a bit? I can't stand it. Watch any more of this confounded thing. All right, Isabel. All right, all right. She says make the film shorter, so I've done just that. I know you wouldn't want me to make the opera any shorter, so I've made the film shorter, get you all in bed a little earlier this evening. You won't miss what you missed anyway. You know what I always say about those films, don't you? Horror Island, oh boy. Now, you remember that Jack Milton was at the Gypsy Cap, and, all right, my dear, suddenly, peals of thunder pour down on Borgia Pass. And then the storm breaks. My dear, that's right, my dear. Oh, my dear. Confound you. You'll have to get with it, kid, that's all. Now, this bad weather, of course, brings out all the monsters in the area, and I have written a spectacular ballet entitled L'Entrate dei Mostri Allegro e Giosi. The entrance of the little monsters. Now, Jack, finding himself entirely surrounded by little jerks, he says, Io sono malade! Io sono malade! Io sono malade! Io sono malade! Io sono malade!
Now, at the first sign of a sore throat, use Isodine Gargle to stop that sore throat pain fast. Only new Isodine Gargle contains iodine, world's greatest germ killer, in a new, safe, pleasant-tasting form. Here's how Isodine Gargle works. This is raw, painful sore throat lining. But Isodine Gargle quickly spreads a new kind of soothing germ-killing film over sore throat area. And here's what germs look like in your sore throat before using Isodine Gargle. After using Isodine Gargle, germ count is way down. And Isodine Gargle tastes good. Get concentrated Isodine Gargle and stop sore throat pain fast.
Chief Wilkins?
Yeah?
I'm Johnny Layton of the Chicago Register.
Glad to see you.
And this is my cameraman, One Shot McGuire.
Hi, Chief.
Howdy.
Say, we're down here to cover that Heath murder, but we didn't get much information at the coroner's inquest. I thought maybe you might be able to help us.
Well, I'm always glad to cooperate with the newspapers, providing they cooperate with me.
That's the policy of our paper.
Well, to tell you the truth, I haven't got very far with the thing myself. Oh, here's something that might interest you. It's a picture of the victim's wound.
Mm-hmm.
You'll be able to see it better with this glass.
Are these scratches on the neck and shoulders?
Yes, but we can't determine the source. They're too deep for fingernails, too shallow to have been made by a knife. They're more like claws.
That sort of bears out Dr. Crothers' theory at the inquest of a wild animal. Have there been any circuses around here lately?
No.
Heard of any animal escaping from a zoo?
No.
Couldn't have been one of those African leopard men. They use steel claws.
This isn't Africa.
Okay, Chief, I was just trying to help.
Chief, are you sure there's no clue you're holding back while investigating?
Well, since you're going to work with me on this case, there is a clue. And a very weird one. The autopsy surgeon says that such wounds could have been made by the beak and talons of a bird.
A bird? Why, there aren't any birds around here big enough to attack a man.
How about an eagle?
We know it wasn't a bird.
How do you know that?
Because we found several hairs on the shoulder of Heath's coat.
Ah, cherchez la femme.
They're not human hairs.
What kind are they?
Well, it may sound silly, but the laboratory test shows that they were from a mouse.
Well, who ever heard of a mouse big enough to kill a man?
Say, a bat has hair like a mouse.
Well, the only bats around here are no bigger than sparrows. There was a peculiar odor about the wounds, but they were so faint and elusive that the police chemists have been unable to identify it.
Then it does give us something to work on.
Well, if the scent was a clue, it's been destroyed by evaporation.
Say, Chief, do you mind if I do a little sleuthing around on my own account?
Certainly not. Go ahead. If I can help you anyway.
You can. Miss Heath seems to be the nearest to an eyewitness of the crime. I'd like to have a talk with her. Can you arrange it?
I think I can.
Well, Dr. Carruthers refused to let her speak to us. We tried that this morning at the inquest.
Well, don't you worry about Dr. Carruthers. He's one of the finest men in Heathville. He just thought you'd add to Mary's grief so you could get sensational newspaper stories. I'll arrange an interview.
Thanks, Chief. I'll keep in touch with you.
All right. 48J.
Miss Heath, did your brother have any enemies that you know of?
Why, no. Everybody in the village liked Roy.
Mm-hmm. Well, what did he do at the factory?
He had charge of the experimental department where the new products are developed. Oh, here comes Dr. Carruthers. Hello, Doctor.
Hello, Mary. I took a shortcut from my laboratory through the garden hedge.
You met Dr. Carruthers at the inquest this morning.
Yes. Mr. Layton, I hope you'll forgive me if I seemed a little abrupt. But I'm fond of Mary. And considering the ordeal she already went through, I wanted to protect her from dwelling too much on the tragedy.
Of course. You were quite right.
We're working on the case with the police now.
Yes, I understand. Chief Wilkins phoned me. And if I can be of any assistance, just call on me.
Thanks.
Won't you sit down?
Shall I serve, Mademoiselle?
No, Maxine, I'll do it. You may go now.
Oui, Mademoiselle.
Do you take sugar, Mr. McGuire?
Huh? Oh, no, ma'am, never. In fact, I don't even take tea. If you'll just deal me out, I'll take a look around. I may dig up a clue.
What do you think of Dr. Carruthers' theory about a wild animal, Mr. Layton?
Well, frankly, I don't think much of it.
I can't say that I blame you. But I, as a scientist, take many things into consideration a layman might overlook.
For instance?
The jagged nature of the wound, the rapidity with which the murderer escaped, the scratches from talons or claws.
But when an animal attacks a human, there's bound to be a lot of noise. You heard Miss Heath testify there was no sound of a struggle.
No. Only those awful screams.
It's very puzzling, very mystifying.
Doctor, when you last saw Roy, did he seem worried or nervous or moody?
No, not at all. On the contrary, he was in the best of spirits. Mm-hmm.
Well, I've got to get back to the village now and file my story. You'll excuse me?
If you find it necessary for us to talk again, you may come back at any time.
This evening, if it's all right with you. I'd like to spend some time here.
Well, yes, that'll be quite all right.
Thank you. Goodbye, Miss Heath.
Goodbye.
Goodbye, Doctor.
After that touching aria, we have the, what we have? Oh yes, we have the mummies. That's why I'm all jazzed up here. The mummy, entrance of the mummies, you know, we have the all-male mummies chorus here this evening. I got them down below there. And the point is, of course, that, as you all recall, that the mummies, the whole ballet is based on that wonderful mummy business of, you know, the walk, you know. Now, we'll all begin. All right, boys. Ready, boys?
One of his legs is longer than it really ought to be.
No. Wait. Hold it, my dear. I realize, of course, with all the bandages across the mouths, it's been a little difficult for you to understand, so I'll go along with them. All right, boys. Letter RX there. Ready? Here we go. One of his legs is longer than it really ought to be. We all began to pity him and give our sympathy. But Jack doesn't care. You're just many more like me that has a leg that's shorter than it really ought to be. One of his legs is longer than it really ought to be. Delightful, my dear. Absolutely delightful. Now, of course, you know that by now the jolly monsters have left without telling Milton where Castle Dracula is. This, of course, makes Milton very cross. So after whipping a peasant or two to relieve his inhibitions, he finds his way to the cave, where his brother is at. Larry Talbot, the werewolf, who is frozen in the ice. Now, Larry is melted out, and he sings the great baritone aria, "Look, Mamma Mia, no hair." Milton's eyes fill up with tears as he peels the onions for supper and listens to Larry's glorious voice as he recites his favorite theme song.
Getty. It was a bat. I saw it kill Tommy Heath.
Listen, Johnny, I want you in One Shot to come on home or I'll fire both of you.
I'm not coming home and neither is One Shot. I'm keeping him here to get a picture of the devil bat. Say, that'll look great in the headlines. Devil bat strikes again.
Listen, don't tell me it had horns. Maybe I better send a wagon with the steel bars and the strong boys with the straitjackets.
Look, Joe, have I ever lied to you?
Plenty of times.
Well, I'm not lying this time. If it ever got out that I cooked up a fake story about a devil bat, I wouldn't be able to get a job on a country weekly. Print the story, Joe. So help me, it's on the level.
All right, I'll print it. But I won't believe it. Not till One Shot gets me a picture of that devil bat in action.
Don't worry, he'll get it. Goodbye. You, my friend, are going to get a shot of the devil bat in action.
Who, me?
How? Have you noticed there's a taxidermy shop in the village?
Well, you wouldn't suggest that I go out and stuff a bird, would you?
One Shot. To think that you'd even hint that I would suggest you have the village taxidermist build you a nice big bat for pictorial purposes. Besides, a bat isn't a bird, it's a mammal.
Well, why didn't you say so in the first place? Where is this bird stuffing emporium? Oh, down on Cottage Grove Avenue. Idea, Frenchie. You hang on to the bat till I get my camera set up. And when I raise my hand, you give the bat a good shove, and it'll swing out just like it's flying. Then I can get a swell picture from a boss. Get it?
Oui. I am wise, no?
No. But Hang on to the bat until I raise my hand, huh? What's the idea of breaking up my devil bat? I'm going to make you pay for that.
And I'm going to take you to jail until you explain this. Come on.
You can't do this to me.
I'm doing it.
I was just conducting a little experiment, trying to find out how the devil bat does his killing.
I'm sure McGuire didn't intend doing anything wrong. He's just a little overzealous about his work.
Well, with the town in an uproar, and everybody terror-stricken, wondering whether he's going to be the next victim, I don't want any more trouble stirred up. Even with an artificial bat.
You'd better get back to the hotel. I want to talk to the chief alone.
Is it all right, Chief?
Yeah, but be careful in the future.
Ever smelled anything like this before?
Well, yes. That's the same stuff that's been on every one of the devil bat's victims. Where'd you get it?
Found it in Don Morton's bathroom.
Find out where Morton got it?
No, I didn't want to arouse suspicion by asking questions till after it's been analyzed.
You think it has any connection with the murders?
That's the way it strikes me, but I can't figure out how.
I'll get the police cameras on it right away.
I'll snoop around and see if I can find out where Morton got it.
Well, it probably came from down at the Heath Cosmetic plant. I've been working on a theory of a disgruntled factory employee committing the crimes.
It's certainly more than coincidental that all the victims have been members of the Heath and Morton families.
Yeah. Looks like a plot to wipe them all out.
I wish the rest of them would leave town until this crime is solved.
You're worried about Mary, aren't you?
Well, yes. I've been urging her to leave, but she won't go without her father. And he insists on remaining here to help clear up the crime.
Worse than that, neither Heath nor Morton will let me give them a bodyguard.
I guess we'll just have to wait for something to break. Good night, Chief.
Good night, Johnny.
Now, after they have supped and put the candelabra in the sink for the gypsy woman to clean up, they go upstairs to the torture chamber and hide behind a chair. There they find Count Dracula making improper advances to Princess Sinanka. She cries piteously, "Down, boy!" In the trance at the spectacle, Milton coughs slightly. Count Dracula turns on him in a fury. In a fury, just a moment, in a fury. In a fury, and he says... He cries, rather. Esci fiore di dietro quella sedia! Come from out behind that chair, you! Peek-a-boo, peek-a-boo, come out from behind that chair. Peek-a-boo, peek-a-boo, I see you hiding there. Peek-a-boo, out from behind the chair. Peek-a-boo, peek-a-boo, I see you hiding there. Oh, you rascal, peek-a-boo, peek-a-boo, up behind the chair.
I hope we're not upsetting your work, barging in on you this way.
No, not at all. I'm anxious to help solve these crimes. All the victims were very dear friends of mine.
Here's a sample of the stuff young Morton and the two Heath boys had on them when they were attacked by the devil bat.
Of course, it doesn't make sense to me that a bird would choose only people using that particular stuff.
A bat is not a bird. It's a mammal.
Well, anyway, our police chemists couldn't break down one of the ingredients. We thought perhaps you could.
Why? I compounded this myself. It's a new shaving lotion I'm experimenting with. the ingredient your chemist couldn't break down, I discovered years ago in Tibet.
How did you happen to put it in a shaving lotion?
Oh, the lamas use it in some of their religious rites as a perfume. The scent is very pleasant and can't be imitated by competitors.
But what were Don Morton and the two Heath boys doing with the stuff?
Oh, it is the policy of our firm to try out any new product before marketing it.
Well, that knocks our theory into a cocked hat.
Yeah. We were hoping the unknown ingredient might turn out to be some sort of a clue.
This isn't the kind of bottle I give it out in. But I presume your chemist changed it when making the analysis.
Yeah.
Is there anything else I can do to help?
Tell me, did you hear Professor Raines on the radio last night?
Yes. It was very interesting and very asinine.
You mean you believe there is a devil bat?
Why not? You saw it, didn't you?
Well, sure I did. So did Mary.
Then why worry about what one scientist says?
That one scientist got me fired.
Oh, you mean your newspaper discharged you?
That's right.
Oh, that's too bad. Then you're believing Heathsville before the mystery is solved.
I'm afraid not. I'm going to stay here and work with the chief.
Since you're going to stay here for a while, I would like you to try out a bottle of the new lotion and tell me how you like it. And you too, chief.
No, not me, Doc. If my wife ever smelled perfume on me, she'd suspect me, sure.
Well, Mr. Layton, I understand you are not married.
All right, I'll try it in the morning when I shave. I guess we'd better be going, Chief.
See you later, Doc.
So long, Dr. Crothers.
Goodbye, Mr. Layton.
My dear, are you ready? Here we go. Peek-a-boo, peek-a-boo, come out from behind the chair. Peek-a-boo, peek-a-boo, I see you hiding there. How lovely, my dear. That's a favorite of the whole opera that I had to tease along with there. Well, now, during the ensuing scuffle between Dracula and Milton, Milton manages to escape and takes a job as a goat herd. Larry is overcome with depression, and he is placed back in his ice cube. Another way, good way to get rid of him, I thought. Dracula flees to a lonely mountain crag, and he has himself there a martini on the rocks. Then he takes the number 17 bus back to the castle, where he sits down and he catches up on the latest vampire fashions, you know. All right, my dear. All right. Confound it. She's a little tiring of the whole mess here. The movie, of course, not the opera, but just the same, I have to humor her a bit. All right, my dear. This piece, she's been learning this for weeks. I'll just go ahead, my dear, just a little bit. Dracula returns to the castle. As he enters, the great iron door in the anteroom opens, and it is Amon-Ra, Princess Ananke's father. He pronounces a dreadful curse, and to get even with him, Dracula has him tied up and thrown into the moat. Isn't that lovely? Of course it is.
bandit. You will be even greater than your unfortunate predecessor.
Let's try that again, that radiant beauty jazz, my dear. Let's the orchestra swells through radiant beauty. And then we go into the wedding festival song, you know, and they all do things. To be married, for the heart will be unruly, really love you truly. Well, to be married, oh, I love you, love you, love you, I love you from the
tonight, and it would be dangerous for me if they found you here.
Intruding?
No, not at all.
I heard you were out stalking the devil bat. Any success?
No, but I thought maybe you might be able to help me.
Well, I don't see how that's possible, but if you can suggest anything.
Well, you could give me some more of that new concoction of yours, that shaving lotion.
But how on earth could that possibly help catch the devil bat?
I've still got a crazy idea that if I douse myself with it, it might attract the killer.
I don't see how you can connect the two. But there is a bottle of the lotion on the table.
Thanks. You see, Doc, I figured out something. All four of the murdered people had this lotion on them when the devil bat struck. Now, my plan is to sit in the garden, and when the killer makes one of those power dives, I'll blast him.
Leighton, I'm afraid all these murders have affected your mind.
Maybe you'd like to come along, Doc, and be an eyewitness.
I'm sure it would be just a waste of time, but I'd be glad to watch your experiment.
Good. I knew I could count on you to help me.
I tell you, Leighton, expecting a bat to be attracted by the scent of a lotion is all foolishness. I think I better run along.
Ah, sit down, Doc. The devil bat's behind schedule tonight. You aren't very chummy tonight. What's the matter?
The firearms always make me nervous.
Oh, I thought maybe you didn't want to be sitting too close to me. Just in case the devil bat does show up.
According to your theory, the killer wouldn't attack me. I haven't any of that lotion on me.
You have now, Doc.
Why did you do that?
To make it a 50-50 proposition, Doc. Now sit down, and don't try any shenanigans. Not so funny when it's your own jugular vein that's in danger. Is it, Doc?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Maybe you made a mistake when you let that devil bat of yours out of the attic tonight. Don't worry about the bat killing you. I'm saving you for the hangman. Tell me, Doc, how did you develop a monster bat like that?
You wouldn't understand the scientific theory.
What are you doing out here?
Young fellow, don't think that you're the only man working on this case. It was lucky I was here, too.
Thanks. Did you kill the devil bat?
No, he got away.
Well, here's one bird that didn't get away, and he's the murderer we've both been looking for. Quick, shoot it! Where is it?
It's gone.
And so's the doctor.
Did you get the bat?
What happened? Doc Carruthers is the murderer. And he's hiding somewhere in the garden.
You fellas get back to the house and guard Mary. Come on.
Doctor? Dr. Carruthers? Doctor? Has anything happened to Johnny? Is he hurt?
They took him up to my place. You better come along with me.
That was Mary.
He's over there.
That devil bat belonged to the doctor, Mary. He created it to commit those murders.
Well, it's too late to help the doc.
Aspetta.
Silenzio! Well, if you must know, my dear, they lived happily ever after, of course. Why not? Who wouldn't be proud and happy to marry the old count after all? I'll tell you one thing, it won't be anybody in this movie tonight. we've got some bad movies here. That one's one of the worst, I think. Some guy had the nerve to call up and said he liked the movie. All right, Larry. I'm coming. I'm coming. I'm coming.